There could be even more complex robots. For example, this robot from Shadow Robotics that keeps this bob from dropping and also from breaking it. And as you can see, it is a cross point of several disciplines like mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, computer science, artificial intelligence, human-computer interaction, and last but not least, the sociology and psychology. You can see that robots could be social. For example, on the left, you can see a project from MIT, Dr. Cynthia Brizel, which called this robot Kasmet, Kismet. She told this is a Turkish, but I think it's a Bulgarian word, Kasmet. So the Kasmet in the left allows to experiment with emotional response in people. This robot could recognize different types of emotions and also could simulate through different eyebrows, gaze, and jaws, could simulate different type of emotions. On the right, you can see a famous Asimo robot that also is capable to recognize surrounding people and is capable of social communication. So robot becomes social. As you can see, it's really a cross point of a lot of disciplines. We'll be focused on the software part, but also on the modeling, and also it works in combination with different microcontrollers and hardware and sensors. Robots are becoming autonomous. You can see this from Grand Challenge 2004-2005, organized by DARPA, and followed by Urban Challenge, Smart Urban Challenge in 2007 in the simulated city environment. And in order to achieve this type of autonomous behavior, or even more, more interesting autonomous behavior, these robots, for example, called androids, real androids, not the operating system, or more specifically, special type of androids called actroids, because they're very like humans. This is the design purpose of these robots, and they're capable of talking, and the robot on the right is capable also of dancing and singing simultaneously. So you can see the robots could become social, and in order to achieve this type of complex behavior, there are certain characteristics that we want robot to exhibit. They should be able to act autonomously. There are different degrees of autonomous behavior. They could be just commanded as with a remote, or they could be partially autonomous. We set the goal, they set the details, or there could be even fully autonomous. We set only the higher goals, and they make their plans by their own. In order to achieve this, they combine reactive behavior, which means they look at the environment and take their decisions how to proceed in order, for example, not to fall from the table. And there is a proactive behavior which allows them to fulfill plans, to fulfill higher order goals. And combination of them is actually very a good combination in order to provide autonomous behavior. And there may be also certain desired characteristics as social ability. Robots could communicate together and with other agents, could be human agents, for example. They can interact with humans around them. And this is very important because without language, which is agent communication language, there are several such type of languages designed. Probably our knowledge would not evolve so much for the last centuries. And we would be at the Stone Age without the language and the ability to codify and to exchange the knowledge. And adaptive behavior and learning is also desired capability. Personality and mobility are not obligatory, but for example, you can see here, okay, just one. You can see here, they could be anthropomorphic or zoomorphic, different type of personality, and they could be mobile. Mobility is orthogonal to other characteristics. They could be intelligent and not mobile, could be mobile and not intelligent. Okay, this is a very brief introduction to the robotics and to the complexity that this field exhibits. Actually, we can think in the bigger perspective on the Internet of Things. Why? Because the robots are maybe the most intelligent things in the Internet of Things. They could be connected with other, for example, this automobile, could communicate with the infrastructure on the road, and with the other vehicles. These autonomous vehicles or robots, which essentially they are maybe the most intelligent things that communicate with other things. And this is the bigger perspective of Internet of Things or the connected world. What we actually mean by Internet of Things, you can see here that our ability to enter data is quite limited compared to the ability of different types of sensors automatically capturing data. This could be cameras, could be temperature reading sensors, could be infrastructure around the road, and so on, and so on. And this would allow the things to react intelligently, to be able to service their own signaling when they need replacing, repairing, recalling, and reducing weight, waste, loss, and cost at the end. So you can see it's a multi-billion or even trillion projected market in the next years, the Internet of Things. And there is a problem, of course, the lack of standards. If you have a remote for each thing, you have separate remote, then probably you have a basket of remotes, and they will not be able to communicate and to integrate all these data streams. And here the standards come. IP version 6 is the basis, but there are also specific standards in the IoT area, which I will be discussing on the next slide. Here you can see that we would like to have a bidirectional communication between with our things. For example, we can make appropriate temperature before we return at home from our mobile. We need a bidirectional communication, and we need application-level protocols that allow us to do this. This could be WebSocket, could be HTTP2 in the future. They allow us to control all the things and to monitor all what we need to monitor from our mobile or from our automobile. It's up to us. So this is the bigger picture, IoT services architecture. Actually, in these two robots, I'm addressing only the war two levels, which are here, the infrastructure level. This is Arduino on this robot, and also Raspberry Pi, and some Java software on the Raspberry, and some Arduino C++ software on the Arduino. And also, we have a device gateway. Actually, a Raspberry Pi acts as a gateway for different type of lower-level microcontrollers. This is the case of the robot. But there could be IoT case where these are different sensors with IP addresses that can send data, for example, using Bluetooth Low Energy or 6LowPAN or IP version 6 or Zigbee, or even mobile or serial communication, for example, I2C, only two wires, plus the supply voltage. So there are different possibilities to integrate lower-level devices to the higher-level gateway. And this gateway provides the entry point for and actually the connection with the services, the intelligent services, which could aggregate the data from many such gateways and different sensors all over the internet. So this is the next layer. This is the bus or aggregation layer. Where we can use different type of message brokers or enterprise service buses. And there's special protocols that allow us to do this. Here are the emerging standards in the IoT area. They're simplified in order to be capable to implement them in resource-constrained environments. For example, QAP, which is the last one, is very interesting. It means constrained application protocol. And it allows us it has only 4 bytes fixed header, and after that, there are some options. And it's over UDP. This means very low overhead. And it's capable also for datagram security, transport level security, DTLS. The other alternatives are MQTT and WebSocket, and there may be also other alternatives. And the important part that these are the communication protocol, but we also want to have a configuration or management protocols. For example, a Mobile Alliance LVM2M lightweight machine-to-machine protocol allows us to have a virtual model for each device in order to acquire the model on the state of this device and to have complete picture on the cloud about different type of end-level sensors and actuators. Okay, and the next layer integrates over this message broker bus, and it is meant to different type of application level services that integrate data, that provide analytics, and that provide platform as a service APIs for the portals, for mobile applications, for they provide different types of dashboard to monitor all these devices here, and they can provide an APIs for third-party services to integrate. And of course, important part is the monitoring, the elasticity layer. It could be based on Docker, plus Kubernetes or Apache Brooklyn, or even could be, for example, if we have a, if we want to deploy these services on the gateway here, we can use, for example, SGI, and this could be also managed by Apache Brooklyn. So this is the partial maybe picture of what the whole the architecture of IoT could look with the standards that are developing now. Let's go further. The important goal in order to make an autonomous robot is to track, keep intact with this complexity, because there are many subsystems that should interact. And we need to model them separately. And this is the place where microservices come. And we want these microservices to be modeled in a domain-driven design fashion. What this means? This means that okay, this methodology is introduced by Eric Evans in the book 2004, Domain-Driven Design, Tracking the Complexity and the Hardware of the Software. And the most basic concepts here are the ubiquitous language and bounded context. The idea is that we have to model our robotic, for example, application, separating different subsystems in different bounded contexts. For example, we have odometry. This is actually the demo I'll be showing. Odometry means how you control the trajectory on the robot in order to go straightly under, on the straight line, for example, or to follow certain trajectory. And to, if there are some disturbances, for example, there may be different speed of the motors, there may be different obstacles in front of the robot, this should be corrected in order to converge to desired trajectory. So this is one such bounded context. There are another context, for example, the camera, which also will be extended with two servos and gimbal, is another context. The third context is this array for following line in the front. And they could be modeled as different types of reactive streams or reactive microservices, very lightweight. Okay, so this is the idea, to separate the things that are could be modeled separately in order to reduce the complexity and to make higher level integration much easier, providing things as aggregate routes. So aggregate routes allow us to focus just on a facade which is domain specific and which hides all the complexity of the underlying, for example, motor commands to these motors and to the motor driver. In the case of commands of odometry. So the basic concepts here are the value and the aggregate model and bounded context coming from the lower to the higher level. So the difference between values and entities is that values are immutable and they're just readings, immutable readings, while entities have their state, they're mutable, and their state could be persisted or could be serialized. But in this application, I try to keep only to immutability. Why? Because reactive programming makes it really easy to make to employ such patterns which rely on immutability. For example, redux pattern, which I'll be talking in code after that. So let's continue. There are also different type of open host services that provide this functionality available, for example, via WebSocket to my web interface, as I will demonstrate. Another interesting tendency in contemporary design of application is the separation of two types of business operations. These are the queries and the commands. You can see here they have quite different requirements. For example, queries don't need transactions. They have event eventual consistency. They prefer denormalization in order to have fast queries, and they rely on caching. And they also can utilize the NAKE object, which are object specifically structured in order to be able to be visualized. Actually, the views could be almost automatically generated by this NAKE object or material views. So on the right part, we have the commands. They need transaction. They are not so happy with eventual consistency. They prefer normalization of the DB in order not to have different type of problems. And also, they usually focus on managing single entities each transaction, while queries often have aggregate data. So we can see these two guys are actually quite different. And we want to model them differently and separately. And this is another interesting feature of reactive programming, that reactive streams could be used to differently model these two types of events or commands and queries. I'll be going to reactive introduction. And first of all, I would say that reactive behavior could be the essence of the universe. Why? Because if we change something, many things also change as a consequence, as you can see in the butterfly effect, for example. But going more technically, reactive programming means that we have our functional relationship followed all the time. For example, in imperative programming, if we have B and C and we compute A, it's computed only once. If we change B, A is not computed. In reactive programming, every change in B or C, which are argument of this reactive binding, automatically changes A. This is a very simple difference between imperative and reactive. So reactive programming means that we A automatically tracks all the time changes in B and C. And this could be done efficiently in a lazy update way. So functional programming is a very well combined with reactive paradigm. They are not the same, but they are very well combined. And functional programming means that we can compose easily our data flows by composing pure functional transformations. Pure functional transformations allow us to reason very easily about what a certain type of code or certain service does. Why? Because there are no side effects. And there are also other good qualities of the functional composition. For example, this is declarative, and we can easily scale it, or you could specify if you want to run it on a thread pool, on a single thread, or using LMAX disruptor ring buffer in a non-blocking way. And this is done declaratively without changing anything in the functional reactive composition. Okay, so let's go further. According to Connell Elliott, which is the father of functional reactive programming term, we have two major properties that make functional reactive programming. This is denotific, which means that functions could be easily composed, and temporally continuous, which means that the changes are lazily propagated all the time. So the time is explicitly modeled. And we have different initiatives that try to standardize reactive systems. Here we have examples like TypeSafe-AK and Spring Reactor and RxJava. There was another presentation. And the basis of all this reactive system is that they're responsive, resilient, to different type of errors or network malfunctions. They're elastic, they can scale up and scale down when need changes. And the basis of all this is the message or event driven communication, which leads us to the next topic, which is about event sourcing. So event sourcing allows us to separate different domains and they could be exposed, for example, as open host services by only communicating using events to, for example, to synchronize the state, to enforce eventual consistency. So let's look at some examples for reactive programming. Maybe this is a most well-known example, reactive extensions for Microsoft. Reactive extensions was made, I think, around 2003, I'm not sure. But the important part is that it combines three types of artifacts. This is observables, or observer pattern, in essence. Schedulers, which mean that we can schedule behaviors in front of time. And also functional compositions and transformation, which in .NET is Link. But this is slightly Microsoft-ish definition of what reactive programming is. You can see there a lot of libraries for different types of platforms here. Almost for every platform, there is a reactive extensions library. There are also different implementations, for example, Spring Reactor, which becomes a basis for the next Spring platform version 5. And we can see here, this is Project Reactor.io. This is the website. You can look for more examples in details. And I'll be talking about Reactor because it's used in this demo, in this project, in more detail. So a reactive script is the specification that allows interoperability between different reactive APIs. Reactive streams is a very simple specification. And it's also part of Java 9. It will become certainly part of Java 9, excuse me, as Flow in Java 2 concurrent, which actually provides four interfaces. It's quite simple. We have a publisher interface that allows different subscribers to connect to. And after connection, they receive a subscription. Subscription allows the subscribers to request how much data, how much messages or events they want to receive. So there is no need for blocking. Why? Because the subscriber will never receive data which is not requested. And this allows us to make all this composition of different types of transformations non-blocking. It could be on a single thread, or subscription, as we can see in Reactor, could be made in another thread. For example, this could be for small task a sync thread, or for longer IO task, it could be a thread pool. So, and this is specified declaratively, very easy, without any code, just by functional composition. And the processor is combination between subscriber and publisher, which means that it's transformer of data in between. And this is implemented in Reactor, this specification. So the next one is providing example using RX Java, reactive extensions for Java, which shows us a very basic example of reactive programming. What we have here, we have from array, we are making observable sequence. Which observable sequence, we take only two elements from this tree, first two, and we are mapping them, concatenating with date. And after that, we are printing the result. And we can see the result here. Very simple example of functional reactive composition. OK. So Project Reactor. Project Reactor becomes very popular in connection with Spring 5, but not only. Actually, it's not a monolith project. It was separated on different sub-projects, as you can see on the next slides. But the important features of Reactor project, or started from Spring, so I call it Spring Reactor, is that it utilizes lower level primitives, making them easy to use. For example, a ring buffer or LMAX disruptor pattern, which allows non-blocking concurrency to be implemented, is very easy to use in a reactor. And if you have a lot of such ring buffers to compose, it makes a difference. So we have high-performance Java, which can be measured in tens of millions of operations per second, high throughput, and low latency. And we can specify all the execution in terms of a functional composition. And it also has all the qualities which Martin Thompson tells us in mechanical sympathy block. How many of you have been looking at mechanical sympathy or high performance Java? Not many, but okay, this is the low level programming in Java in order to achieve latency for high frequency trading, low latency programming in Java, almost real time, soft real time in Java. Okay, and this is, as I mentioned, very easy to use in Reactor. So it uses pre-allocation of the buffers, they are bounded. It uses message passing. It uses reactive event-driven architecture, implements reactive stream specification, which makes it very easy to connect with different other types of reactive libraries, for example, with Java 8 Flow, and also exposes fluent functional API. So this is the structure of a Reactor. We have several sub-projects. Core is at the center, but there are also I.O., which is based on NETI. There are also other implementations which provide non-blocking I.O. that allows us to make, for example, in the demo, end-to-end reactive non-blocking communication with the web browser through WebSocket using RxJS on the browser and Angular 2 and going to WebSocket to the NETI and receiving a reactive stream here, and after that making some type of transformation and producing, for example, motor commands and reporting the readings from the encoders back. We have also other types of extensions here, I think here, yeah, add-ons. And we have Spring integration, and we also have reactive streams RX integration, very easily done. Okay. What are the basic constructs in a reactor? These are the flux, which actually is a reactive stream. You have, it's like promise, but it's promise with several pluses. Why? Because in promise you have one event which could succeed or fail. In flux, you could have many such events. And after receiving some of them, the stream can complete. This means completion. Or there may be a failure, of course, which is drawn as X. And this is the operator which transforms the incoming event stream to outgoing event stream. This is the basis of a reactive composition. So reactive composition is down on fluxes through different type of transformations, functionally specified. And there is a special case of mono, which is actually at most one event, and it resembles similarity with promises, very close similarity. So let's go further. This is another example of a real type operation which I employ on the robot, combining latest data from two streams. For example, this could be stream for encoder readings. Actually, I need two of them, zipped the previous and the next reading in order to compute derivatives like velocity and acceleration for the odometry of the robot. And also we have here a stream of commands, which, for example, allow us to cancel or to stop the robot in the middle of a certain movement. And I use combine latest in order to combine these two streams, the zip position stream and the command stream, in order to decide which commands to provide for the motors. This is the outgoing motors commands, lower level commands going to the motor driver. Okay, This is an example. So let's go to some examples. This is an example for reactor, but I'll very briefly discuss it. I'll be going to the robot examples in more detail. As you can see here, we can use Broadcaster, which is a hot event stream processor. Hot event streams are event streams that are not bounded in time. For example, cold event streams could be made from collections or from database result sets, while hot event streams are continuous in time. And we cannot buffer all the stream most of the time. And Broadcaster is such a primitive for hot event stream in Reactor. And we can schedule it on different type of schedule. For example, a sync schedule is optimized for short tasks run concurrently. But there is also another parallel scheduler, which schedules long running I/O, for example, tasks on a thread pool. So there are different possibilities. There is also possibility to run non-blocking way. We can see here different type of mapping, filtering, and consuming at the end. And we can say provide some data, and all this reactive flow is already assembled, and it goes to the consumer after transformation. So this is an example from the robot already. We have a reactor bus, which is part of add-ons now, and which allows us to implement different types of mesh exchange patterns between different type, different domain modeled services or microservices on the robot. For example, position service, as you can see on the next slides. So we can make a subscription with Buson for this topic, which is IPT pipe position. And when we receive a position, we can do something. And we can publish updates, for example, here. This is the payload. Let's go further. OK, meet IPT pipe. Oops, this is the IPT pipe. IPT pipe is based on Raspberry Pi, as you can see. Actually, the next slides show in more detail different parts. The Raspberry Pi is the gateway for lower-level microcontrollers. For example, we have an Arduino microcontroller here. This is a clone of Arduino Leonardo, very small, very compact. And it takes all the encoder readings and makes the heavy work on aggregating the encoder data, which is high-frequency data. There, every half a millimeter, we have an impulse from the encoders. And we have also this mini IMU, which is a 3D accelerometer, gyroscope, and compass. We have also these motor drivers, and you can see the power supply and so on. We also have a touch screen here, which I hope I'll demonstrate. Of course, our wireless connectivity. OK, this is another robot. You can see it. It's based on Lego and uses LeJOS library for reactive programming. This robot is not programmed reactively. It's just programmed in Java, OK, in order to compare both of them. So you can see here, this is a picture from the demo, which I'll show, which compares the embedded interface on the right with the mobile interface with the same functionality for the commands to the robot. This is the GitHub code. You can see everything in GitHub for J-Prime demo. And this is the picture which shows the event loop. This is the system with feedback. We have the data from encoders aggregated by this small Arduino, and after that sent us a fraction of lower-level encoder data, which is made available to the position fraction, which receives encoder data and tells us where the robot is at the moment, and which is used in order to make adaptive adjustment to the commands in order to follow straight line or to follow certain trajectory, to converge on a certain trajectory. And the WebSocket provides this as a web API. OK, so we can see here some code. This is the Arduino function. As you can see, we receive via serial communication, we receive the data. And after that, we publish this data to the as a function, as you can see here, this is a position function, which uses the encoder's data in order to compute the positions. So actually, this is the top-level class. The top-level class makes the higher-level wiring between different reactive microservices or functions implemented in Reactor. Okay, and let's look at the details. Okay, this is the Arduino data function. We have here, it's modeled as a Reactor function, which provides its publisher of data, the position subscribed for. And we have here reading of the lower level data from the serial interface through a byte buffer. Okay. And we have a position function that receives the data from Arduino and actually provides our position arithmetics. And this is an example of Redux pattern, which allows us keeping the last position. This is the skip one here. This is the actually the next position, and skip one is the previous position, and the next position is encoder readings. So we have both of them in order to compute derivatives, like speed, for example, and all of them have timestamps in order to this computation. And the next position is dependent on the previous position. This is made by this functional primitive scan, which actually implements this Redux pattern very easily, as you can see, as a single functional operator. This is initial state, this is the state change, and we have the next state produced and published. Okay, so this is the lower level GPIO control for controlling motor drivers. It's done directly on the Raspberry Pi, not on Arduino. Okay, there is nothing special here. And maybe the most interesting part is about reactive WebSocket integration. We use here Reactor IO, separate project now, that allows us to implement reactive channels using Netty as an infrastructure or ZeroMQ. And here we have the infrastructure. We publish this as a bidirectional stream. Actually, the streams are unidirectional by their essence, but we have two of them. We have one for commands, and one for responses, or here it said requests. And we also have a completion or closing publisher. So I'll show some code on the next slide. So this is the code that allows us to set up the server. Everything is served in a reactive way. Even the static resources are mapped here, using Reactor IO. And there is also a WebSocket endpoint on the same address, port 80, in which we receive all the commands from the mobile or from the web interface, and we send all the updates of the position and the heading of the robot bidirectionally. And the client part is implemented in RxJS, Reactive Extension for JavaScript, plus Angular 2. In TypeScript. Okay, so going further, we have a WebSocket handler, which shows us how we can utilize these reactive streams. For example, we receive commands on the here on next command. We made it available for and expose it as a reactive function of commands. In order to be able, after that, to consume it at the part which calculates the lower-level commands to the motors. And we also send the encoder data. Okay, and maybe it's time for a brief demo before we go to takeaways. I hope it will be seen. I also have a streaming on my mobile, but probably I hope it will be seen here. So First of all, we have to check the connection with the robot. Let's see it. Do we have a ping? Yeah, we have a connection with the robot. It could be commanded from here, but I'll do it remotely. I'll demonstrate a LaunchPy plugin made by Cvetan Stoyanov, Bulgarian, which allows us to program in our Eclipse environment on the desktop and just to deploy it in a special type of configuration remotely on the Raspberry Pi, and we receive the console. We can also debug it remotely. As you can see here, this is the debugging console. I actually have started it, but I'll stop it and restart now. So I'm deploying. You can see here the code. Okay. This is the main class, IPTPy demo, which actually just assembles different types of functions, making higher level wiring. It's just around 10 lines of code without commands. And it wires different types of functions that are coming from encoders, coming from optical array in front, and there will be also fluxes coming from the 3D accelerometer compass gyroscope, but they're not integrated yet in a reactive way. So I'll be starting this configuration. What you should do is just to go to the main class and run it with special type of configuration, which is Raspberry Pi configuration. I have this is the port, the IP address and the port, and of course the main class and target. So I run it. You can see here the progress. I hope it will deploy fast. Let's see. It's deployed now. And you can see this is the console, the remote console. You may see here, I don't know, maybe not, but embedded interface shows up because the demo is started. I'll not be doing this from the embedded. I'll doing from the WebSocket, a web-based interface here. Okay, so let's refresh. On the right, I have also my WebSocket lock here. I'll have it shortly. And these are the real streams, real-time streams coming from the robot. And there are also animation of the robot heading here, as you can see now. Okay, I'll be commanding the robot to go straight away. Please go. Oh, sorry. Yeah, you can see here, these are the real-time events, or maybe back. These are the real time, and you can see here they're updated in real time. And you can see there is only 0.05 millimeters difference in the heading of the robot after going through several movements in front and back. This is because of odometry algorithms employed. For example, I'll demonstrate. If I start it, but I'll do it, for example, going for 80. Centimeters with a velocity of 50. Oops, sorry. Velocity of 50. Okay. And let's do it. So I'll be keeping this wheel from moving, you see. And the robot goes straight. I'll be keeping this wheel from moving, but the robot goes straight. Why? Because of the reactive streams which compensate for the different speed of the movement of the motors. It tries to converge to the desired trajectory. For example, this one makes a left turn. It's moving slowly in purpose because I would like to show it here. And yeah, we could do it also in the other direction. And you can see that the end difference in heading after moving left and right is only, let's see how much it is. Okay, 0.06 radians is the only difference in the angle. So it follows the desired trajectory very closely. Okay, this is the basic odometry demo, which I wanted to present. We have 2 minutes to tell some things at the end. So first, the benefits of reactive programming for IoT and robotics could be that combined with domain-driven design, it helps us to manage the complexity of a robotic system with many subsystems that could be modeled separately and could be deployed separately, for example, as OSGI models on the robot. And there are also services that could be deployed on the cloud, for example, using Docker. And we can utilize Kubernetes or Apache Brooklyn in order to manage this elastic cloud of services. We receive CQRS without any effort. Why? Because these streams are unidirectional. They use only value types, immutable data, and they use pure functional composition that allows us to declaratively specify what we want to do and to scale it very well in the cloud if we want. And to specify separately what type of concurrency we want for our reactive stream. Declaratively, as we saw on a previous example, for example, on a sync scheduler in Reactor. And we can utilize blocking or non-blocking, it's up to us. You can utilize LMAX disruptor without any cost of complexity introduced in the project to this higher level abstraction provided by Reactor. We can use Redux pattern, which allows us to manage the state. Out of the box, we saw the scan for the positions employing the Redux pattern. And you can utilize this for replaying. For the robots, it's very important to be able to replay the same sequence of commands, same sequence of events in order to see, for example, if something goes wrong, where is the problem? And we have all this because the events are replayable very easy. This is the advantage of event sourcing and going event-driven. And we can also make a time travel, and we can also make a data analytics based on these events. And we can make a transformations that scale in the cloud using MapReduce, big data, and providing platform as a service. For example, if this is not a robot, but these are many, many thousands of sensors deployed, for example, another project we are working on about precision agriculture that you can irrigate and fertilize your plants at home remotely. Okay, so domain-driven design allows us to separate different subsystems easily and to make the communication integration between them very easy. And reactive streams combine very well with this domain-driven design paradigm and with CQRS. And with Redux pattern. But of course, there are cons. The cons is that we have to spend some additional efforts in order to make this separation between different bounded contexts or subdomains. And we have to learn a whole new language because reactive language is like learning a foreign language. It's very, very different from imperative programming with cycles and if and else. We have different primitives. The good part is if you learn RxJava or Reactor, or RxJS, reactive extension for JavaScript, or Rx for every platform supported, we have to learn it only once, and you can program on JavaScript Reactive, on Java Reactive, on Reactive, or reactive extensions for Java. There is absolutely the same primitives, primitive constructions used. So you have to learn the foreign language only once, not for each platform separately. And of course, we would like better support for reactive programming and for auto-completion in Eclipse, at least maybe in other IDs, there is better. Okay, so this is some additional resources. You can look for the robots here, and for high-performance Java, we are providing course at IPT, Intellectual Products and Technologies, my company. And there are also lectures from my Sofia University course on social robotics and multi-agent systems here. And Of course, I would like to invite you, if you're interested in reactive programming for embedded and IoT and robotics, to come to Roboune Hackathons. We organized several such hackathons, and the next one will be the next month. We announce the date. It will be on Angular 2 plus Ionic 2 in order to provide mobile interfaces for IoT and robots. Okay, and also if you're interested, you can meet us on another Big Oracle conference and TuxCon in Plovdiv after several days. Okay, and that's all. Thank you very much, and you're welcome for questions. If you have questions, or if you would like to see the robots, they will be tomorrow also. If you're here, I'll bring them, and you can look at the Hacker Garden. We tried to make some additional speech talking from the robot, and but there is not much time. So if you're interested, I may show you what we made during the Hacker Garden today. Okay, thank you very much. Thanks.